down throughout the auditorium. Action stations, this is not a drill. Are you ready, New York Comic Con 2021? Then it is my absolute pleasure to welcome you to the stage. Two amazing stars that we're secured for mission one. Thank you. It is my absolute pleasure to welcome to the stage two amazing actors that are part of this fantastic series, Battlestar Galactica, reimagined by Ronald D. Moore and a crew and a cast of fantastically talented people. Giving us a television series that moved the needle for television in general, took us to the stars and back again, and had us ask a lot of questions about ourselves, where we are, and where we're going, and we got to blow up some robots along the way. How about that? So it's my absolute pleasure, let's welcome out our cast today. First, she is an award-winning actress whose body of work includes Independence Day. Got some fans of that? Dances with Wolves, fans of that? The series Rebel, some fans of that? And recently in The Witcher! Today she joins us to discuss the role of the former Secretary of Education turned President of the 13 Colonies in Exile. Please welcome Mary McDonnell.
Hello, everybody. New York! Yes! You made it! Oh my goodness, you are a treasure to this whole country. Thank you for leading the way the last couple years. I love you.
Includes Blade Runner, the wonderful ice cream suit. All right, we got some out there, right? Mayans MC, and of course, Stand and Deliver. Today, he joins us to discuss the role of Commander and later Admiral William Adama. Please give it up for Edward James Olmos.
Incredibly guilty being able to do this, take it off. No, not like that. But I mean, I just want to say to all of you, thank you for being willing to sit there masked while we're up here unmasked. It is so, what's the word, generous. And we keep them on. We did this at another one because we feel bad, but then you don't get to see our faces, so off with it.
Ditto.
And that's the shortest answer he's gonna give all day.
By far.
Well, Edward, great to see you again. Mary, so good. Glad to finally meet you in person. And before we get started, on behalf of myself and this wonderful audience, I just want to thank you both for being a part of this. As I said, this series was so groundbreaking, and again, it was part of that really interesting golden era of that new golden era of 21st century television, the double zeros, and you and the cast and the crew and everything else really set things in motion for broadening entertainment, greater roles for actors and actresses, greater opportunities for writers, and greater means of expression. And a lot of that can be traced back to BSG. So I thank you both for your talents, and I thank you both for your professionalism, and I thank you for the performances you brought to these roles.
Okay, that's it. We're bringing him on the road.
What I'd love to hear, and for audience to know, if they don't already, how did BSG begin for each of you? When did this blip on your radar of, hey, you want to come on in and do a sci-fi project?
I came because you were on the show.
Yeah, but they told me you were waiting to see who was going to do it. I wasn't supposed to tell you that. Anyway, all the secrets come out at these panels. I was at lunch. This is going to sound like a cliche, but I was actually at a lunch with my agents at Sardi's. I've never been before since. They said, we have a script that's on its way over for you. It's an offer. We're not sure what you're going to think. And I said, well, is there money involved? Yes, but we're not sure for how long. And I'm like, okay, so she's going to die. Which, in fact, I was right. But anyway. So they told me it's a remake of that amazing series in the 80s or 70s, whenever it was, Battlestar Galactica, which I was a New York actress at the time. And I was on the stage, and I didn't have a TV. I never saw it. So I said, oh, well, I'll go research it, and who's the character? And they said, well, she wasn't in it. Okay, so, all right, I'll read it, but I couldn't put it together. I couldn't put, you know, Woman of the Prairie Stands with a Fist into the pristine world of sci-fi. And I thought, this isn't gonna work. And I read it that night, and I called them, and I said, I'm in, what do I have to do? What do I have to do? I cannot believe this pilot. It's gonna be extraordinary, and then, they told me about Ed, and I said, but I need to meet these people because if I'm gonna be in Canada, and I also had a middle-aged son who I would be, you know, lead in the middle-aged. I'm about 250 years old. The hair, right? The hair does it? Middle school, and I was like, well, be leaving him, that's not a good idea, ever, to leave that. So I met them the next morning for breakfast, and my question to Ron Moore was, is this a short commitment or a long commitment? This woman is dying of cancer in the first scene, and it's terminal. So what's the scoop? And Ron Moore didn't miss a beat and said in that gracious, intelligent, thoughtful way, no, she will be with us the entire time. She will go in and out of remission, but she will pass when they find Earth. So there you have it. And he stayed true to his word. I got a little nervous when we found the Earth that wasn't Earth. And I thought, oh, Jesus God, I hope he loves me. Because this could be his way out now, and I have to send this second kid to college, please. But anyway, thank God, it wasn't. And you know why? He couldn't do that to me then, because this relationship. This relationship had blossomed, and all of you, thank you, people, for loving a relationship in your older years.
You're not wrong. One of the great strengths of this series is that it's a love story between your two
members.
Absolutely. and take it from the combative nature up front to the building of the friendship to, again, that one scene when came off the thing, just stared at each other, and about time.
And then there was that weekend. Where, I don't know what we were smoking. Anyway. We never figured it out. It was sort of whatever you want it to be. Tell your story.
Ditto. Same thing happened.
You were not in Sardis. I'm sorry.
No, basically, it was the story. The story and the script. I had not seen the original because I, too, was doing theater. When you do theater, you're 8 days a week. You're on stage. And you're there from around 5 o'clock in the afternoon or evening to at least 9 or 10 o'clock at night. And then by the time you get home, it's 12, so you gotta do it all over again. So we had Monday nights. We were closed, we were dark on Mondays. So they didn't show it then. Battlestar wasn't on Mondays. So basically.
No PCRs.
Yeah, basically it was, it was the script, because I had done Blade Runner, and by doing Blade Runner, I kind of felt that I had touched that world in a way that was enough. I thought that was an excellent way to do sci-fi. I had been offered work in other sci-fi shows, and I had not taken them, and so my agency was a little tentative about trying to push it on me because they knew how my feelings were. But I read the script, and it was the script that actually got to the point of it becoming a reality for me. It's one of the finest pieces of work I'd read, whether it was sci-fi or not. It had nothing to do with the genre. It had everything to do with the story. And you can lower the mic a little bit because you're feeding back. But basically, I really felt that, again, I was very fortunate to be able to be a part of this one. This one, beyond my wildest dreams. This is the best usage of television I've ever been a part of in my life. And I've done a lot of good work.
Absolutely, some of the best acting. You had so many wonderful castmates on that show. As a fan of the original Battlestar Galactica, I wanted to ask you about working with Richard Hatch, who carried the flag and kind of helped keep the pilot light alive for Battlestar Galactica as a viable property. Eventually, we brought on board, and I was so glad the role they gave him. Because again, like yourselves and other actors, they gave him a lot to chew on. They really gave him a lot. The villain, then an ally, then a hero, and back to a villain who never was a mustache twirler. But what was it like? What was your experiences like working with him?
Well, you see, I'm sure you're all familiar with the fact that he was literally one of the nicest humans on the planet. If you ever met him at a convention, he would find out something about you almost instantly, and then he would do a deep dive in conversation. He was gracious, he was a gentleman, he was handsome. Always like that. So are you. And you. All of you. You're just great.
My favorite panel ever.
This role for him was a dream come true for him. Because of that kind of complex Machiavellian, like, he never knew quite where it was coming from, and he delighted in sort of committing completely to him. He said over and over and over again, it was one of the best roles he ever played. So, in memory of Richard, we just all feel lucky to have had that time with him.
Oh yeah, no, what a gentleman. Anyone that got to meet him, and I'm sure that most of you have, unless this is your first convention, because he went to a lot of conventions in his lifetime, and he kept the mantle of Star High. He really did an incredible job of trying to get them to refocus themselves in, that the industry would refocus itself in on it and tell the story that still needed to be told. So when we came about, and he was very, very skeptical about the program, and what he had such a feeling for it that he didn't want it to be, you know, damaged in any way. And so he had a lot of fear about it at the beginning. And but boy, he became the biggest proponent of the program ever. The best acting he's ever done is in this program. He's the one who said it many times over. He says, this is the best work I've ever done in my life. And if you watch the program, you'll see why and how he feels that way.
And my final question, what's the best memory that you've both taken from being a part of this?
Why don't you go first? No, and then I'll ditto.
She was the best thing that came out of the whole program. We became friends in the year 2003. I knew who she was, and she knew who I was, and we were very respectful.
We worked together for 5 minutes.
Yeah, we had done one program, but it wasn't really like we were working in the same scene together. We did...
No, you sat in the courtroom.
Yes, well, right.
In my 5 minutes.
Yeah, you were the judge. But anyway, became something way more than any of us really anticipated, because we had the original story, but we didn't see beyond the 4-hour miniseries or, you know, the beginning of the whole thing. So, but once the relationship started, we knew that this was going to be a hell of a journey, because there was such bitterness at the beginning, and there was such a tremendous sense of ego on the part of Adama, and she had a bigger one. So she just quit on me.
True. ditto, A. Sort of beginning with the complexity of the relationship that evolved between us because of the way that we both work. It allowed growth and surprise, and then they would write into it. And Ed and I developed, I wouldn't say it was instant trust, because we had to play such a hostility at the beginning, but even in that, there was trust. And that developed into the roles that you saw, into the love affair, and then we have a dear friendship, and our families know each other, and Ed was one of, I think, only maybe 4 or 5 people, including Mina Sharp, wherever she is, our amazing handler, who came to my house during COVID. That's how much I value this guy, because I was like, no, nobody can come. And I remember I tried to give him breakfast one morning, and I don't cook. We ended up having, peanut butter and jelly toast? And he pretended that he loved it. So truly one of the best things that came out of it was this. And one of my funniest memories of all of us was we were on the earth that wasn't earth. And this is kind of me also wanting to just mention that I stand with IATSE. And we were on the planet that wasn't Earth, and it was right before the writer's strike, and we all had cell phones now. We made this pact that we wouldn't bring them, but everybody had them in their pockets. Oh, he's a gentleman too. Thank you. And they said cut at one point, and everybody pulled out their cell phones and went, we're on strike, and started running around like, I don't know, chickens without heads or something, but I remember laughing so hard because it was sort of children in a schoolyard being told recess was going to last a year. Anyway, it's just a good memory.
So, everybody fight.
Yay, Ayatsi.
As an equity card holder, I support our Ayatsi cousins. And now I would love to invite our wonderful audience to take questions. We should have some microphones set up, I believe.
Do we have any?
Oh, yes. Over here on that side, the blue shirt, microphone over there, and yes, the microphone over there.
One there.
So, all right. So I'll tell you what, we'll take the. Take the fellow in the with the upside down hair. Yeah, you. That's a Disney joke. Sorry. So what we'll do is we'll go from one on that side, one on that side, and we'll swing back and forth. So, hey, what's your name?
Hello, David.
Hi, David.
David.
Absolute fan of Battlestar Galactica. You guys were fantastic. Thank you so much. My question is about when it was revealed that they're the final five Cylons. I'm curious if you guys have any funny stories, if you didn't know who they were, how the cast sort of felt about that. You know, there's a little mistrust, who's really a Cylon kind of thing. Did you guys know immediately, or was that something you guys had to work through with the story?
No, I didn't know. There was one person, the chief, Aaron, who actually found out who the five, the last final five were, but we didn't know at all until we read about, when we read the script, the names were there, but we found out the same time that a lot of the actors who were portraying those roles found out, and they were pissed. Especially from Michael Hogan, who's a wonderful, wonderful person. And he was so angry. And he took that. He stormed out of the reading. Stood up and said, bullshit. He couldn't take it. I'm not kidding you. I mean, everybody went, whoa. I mean, he's serious. This is a character guy. We pay you to do this. Yeah, right. Good luck.
That's a great point. And it's a great question.
Thank
because
you.
It really was, we were all profoundly paranoid waiting to find out. Like really, truly. I mean, Ed and I were pretty sure we weren't Cylons. Like, how do you do that?
You could have fooled me. Pretty convincing in the scenes when you said,
Well, yeah, I know. But the actor's psyche and commitment emotionally to the character they have embodied, particularly for years, it's deeply personal. So Michael Hogan particularly, and most of the actors, you can't help but feel betrayed for a while. And that is something that I don't think studios, producers, anyone has ever really, really understood. How personally we need to take the work to give it meaning. And the terrifying, almost Sybil-esque experience of becoming someone else.
Sleeper agent, yeah.
Yeah, sleeper agent. And so the idea that who you were playing for all these years and giving your heart and soul to is actually something entirely different was really upsetting. It worked out
literally,
okay.
Literally was some mind-blowing for him especially. He took the work right into the scenes. He was so, you could see it in his face. If you start to watch from the time that he receives the information, he's walking around listening to the song, and he's becoming crazier and crazier on the ship. And it finally snaps and becomes, when he enters the room for the first time and all five of them are in the hangar bay for the very first time, you see it in his face, how angry he is and how disgusted he is with the other guys. because they're all silos.
Yeah, his
so
friends,
are you, Michael.
You know, I have to admit, though, and then we can move on. We'll do that. We could talk about this forever because it was a huge moment. It's a great question. But I will say there was a tiny part of me that thought, oh, wait a minute. If I'm a Cylon, I'll get all these new clothes. And I can.
Shit.
No, I mean, I kept saying to the writers, why am I in the same suit? And the Cylon women are showing up with new cute little outfits every day. Like, what? Where'd they get their clothes? Why can't Laura ask them for some?
Thank you, David. Hi, what's your name?
Hi, my name's Eva.
Hello, Eva.
And while I know it's a long show with lots of great moments and character growth, is there sort of a moment that you each feel is very emblematic of who your character really was, like at the core throughout the show?
I found out who Laura's, what drove Laura. There was a little bit a mystery to Laura herself when his life was threatened and she said, I'm coming for all of you. And when I played that moment and they allowed me to play it, I went, okay, I see who's been driving this engine. There was this powerhouse of rage that this woman had been carrying about everything. She'd lost everyone and everything in her life, even before, the beginning of Battlestar. And so that was just a really profoundly insightful moment to see what we actually carry as humans that we don't express, given our circumstances. And then, but when push came to shove, and the person that she had found love with, probably for that kind of love for the first time in her life, was truly threatened, there was nothing she wouldn't have done. And so that was an enlightening moment for me. Thank you.
I would have to say with my character, the most difficult scene and the one of the strongest scenes that I played in was the scene where I put the ring on her finger and she's dead. And in the Raptor, it was extremely difficult to do. And it was the last thing we shot together as the actors that we were in the show. And to me, it ended up becoming the truth of what, life is. The cycle is total and every one of you are gonna die. Okay. Yes. So come to terms with it now. Realize it, okay? Stop this whole thing. Well, it's not gonna happen to me. Okay. Yeah. Right. So, but basically, I will say that the whole show spun my head around. I've done a lot of work. I've been able to do a lot of different characters in my lifetime, and some of them have been very tragic, some of them have been very funny. You guys didn't see the wonderful ice cream suit. I could tell by the way you guys were sitting there. None of you saw it. But anyway, the key to the whole thing has been that what happens to the character throughout the entire piece. And when I got to the end of this show, and I'm sitting on the edge of the mountain, and she, gravestones and everything. She's sitting right next to me. And I'm sitting there and I'm overlooking the beauty of the world that we're in now. It kind of summed it up. You should see what happens to him. That's Battlestar, the Next Generation.
Ava, thank you. Great question.
Hey, how are you?
Hey, what's your name?
My name is Evan.
Evan.
I remember reading an article years ago about directing the play movies after for more Battlestar movies. What were some of those ideas that you had
the plan was a very difficult journey. That was so, it was left open to the writer and myself to be able to use all the story from the beginning all the way through to the end. And we couldn't quite, it was so big, it was just really difficult to try to lock in certain moments and trying to get it together. For those of you that saw the plan, it was a love story. And it became really evident that the Cylons were much more than we anticipated and were much more into understanding themselves than we had given them light to. And so it fed really well, but it was a difficult, it took us a long time to edit that film. And even Ron had no idea where it was going. And what's your name, God? I forgot her name.
I don't know, I wasn't in it, darling.
You were in it. You were in it. We used a lot of your
It cuts. Didn't tell the whole story.
But in essence, the story itself was a love story. And that's what, when Ron finally saw it, he goes, wow, I didn't expect it to come out this way. And I said, I didn't either. Just that's what was fed by the material that he had given us and by what the story was about. So I liked it. I personally enjoyed it a lot, and I enjoyed doing it. Thanks for the question.
Thank you.
First off, thank you both so much for actually coming here today. Really appreciate you. You've been kind of touching on this, but I want to say Battlestar is one of my favorite shows because I really love the ending of Battlestar, and I feel like it is oftentimes difficult to end a TV show well, where you feel pretty satisfied, and I do in Battlestar, especially between the scene at the end with you two. But I was wondering, do you also feel that way about the ending of the series, or if you could change anything or tweak some things, would you have wanted to see that done?
Don't get me started.
Come on.
I loved it. I'm making a joke because, very frankly, I just die too damn much on screen. But I love the ending. It was very hard for me to, as Mary Laura, really comprehend the final ending, to really sort of understand it. It took me years to go back and look, to really appreciate, you know, see Baltar and Six walking through Manhattan. I had to work at that because I was so inside the story when I was playing it. But I think Ron Moore's a genius, flat out. So, I'm good.
No, I agree with Mary. The story, I appreciated it. I really did, because he brought us back to this world 200,000 years ago, which is really, you go, what? Yeah. We came in here and they were barely starting, the humanoids were barely starting to, some of them had found their voice, were actually making sounds and relating to one another, others still weren't. And that's how far back we go, and or where we start, and which then gives your whole mind. If you stop and think, here are these people that were spread out throughout the planet, and they all went their separate ways. And you know, I went up into the mountain, and I built my log cabin. And, you know, but you start to realize, well, wait a minute, how did, you know, where did we come from? How, that whole concept, Ron was brilliant in making you think. And the things that you thought about when you saw this program are still with you today. And I've said it quite a few times in different times, that if there was a nuclear holocaust and everything was taken away from us, every single friend, every pet, everything that you know, every book, everything was just completely wiped out, and you find yourself by yourself maybe amongst other people, humans, but none of them that you're relating to or you've ever seen before. You're just like strangers, and you get to that level. If you've seen this show, you'll understand that you have to go on. You have to help and make it happen again. Advance humanity, and even in the midst of total disaster. But if you haven't seen this show, you'll probably commit suicide.
Thank you, Jennifer. Great question. Hey, what's your name?
Hi, my name is Carlos. My question is, there are actions and decisions that both Adama and President Roslin make, and as actors, have you ever struggled to understand why they make those decisions, and that, you know, this isn't me as a person, but this is what this character is doing?
Well, I think for me, to be perfectly honest with you, the whole experience of playing Laura was that. Because the sort of radical decisions she needed to make were all about coming back to the survival of the human race, which doesn't give you the freedom to have personal politics. And I think about that a lot today, given everything we're going through. It's like somebody has to make some clear decisions to keep life going, to keep life alive. And so it was a continual process of getting Mary's whatever, liberal, progressive, yada yada, Hollywood actress, used to live in New York, out of there. Because Laura had to ban abortion. Laura had to do many things that Mary would not do. Let's not talk about Texas. I'm sorry, I can't help it. I'm so angry. I am so angry. And I don't know, I honestly don't know the name of that wonderful judge that stood out yesterday, but whoever you are, Judge, if you happen to watch this panel someday on YouTube, I would love to take you to dinner. Anyway, you know what I'm saying? Sort of, Laura was a constant process of getting Mary's ideas about right and wrong out of the way, and Laura had often to fly by the seat of her pants, but it was always about how do we keep the most people alive and not allow this beautiful thing called human to end. And so never in my life did I think I would get something like an airlock at my disposal. But I must say I really wish I had one.
You notice that Adama never airlocked anyone. Next question.
Thank you, Carlos.
Great meeting, thank you. Mary, I'm a huge fan of yours since May 1.
Oh, thank you.
And I wanted to ask you, I used to teach Bible school in Southern Kentucky and Hazard.
I'm sorry, slow down a minute. I'm older.
I taught Bible school in Hazard County, Kentucky, so I was very familiar with that life when I saw Nate Mon, and I wanted to ask you what you saw as a continuity between Elma and Laura.
Yeah, that's a good question. First of all, Elma Radner in Mate One, for those of you who didn't see Mate One, you should. It's a beautiful John Sayles film. It's about the unionization of the coal mines in West Virginia in the early 1900s. And Alma was also a very single person. She was an independent woman who ran a boarding house she had a strength that she was unaware of. So I see the root of that sort of untapped reservoirs of strength that a woman who's just simply trying to survive discovers. But that was my first movie. And it was such a glorious experience because John Sayles is just an absolute master of independent film. And I was working with the great Alfred, no, not that one, the next one. I was working with James Earl Jones, David Strathairn, Chris Cooper. I mean, the cast is just, it was beyond. And I learned what really economical movie making is, because John works completely independently, so the budgets are small and he works really fast. And so I thought that you did a couple of takes and that was it, because that's what I was taught. So I learned how to work fast and trust instincts. And that paid off in Battlestar. We had to work fast, and it's paid off in a lot of my life in certain situations. So Mate One was an absolute gift, and Alma taught me about that kind of woman that I had in me that I didn't know before then. And it, that same human with unconscious reserves of strength, when called on, I was able to expand on as Laura. I hope that made sense.
Rochelle, how are you? This question is for both of you. What has been the best feedback that you've received, either about your performance or your character, from your peers or your fans? And why did it make an impression on you?
I think it comes from all of you. The impression is really intense and it's beautiful. The thing that I didn't know anything about the conventions, even though I'd done some work, like I said, Blade Runner and that. I'd never been to a convention. And some of the cast started going, and they said, please, you have to come. They're really asking for you. They really want to see you. And I said, oh, okay. I'll go with you guys and we'll do it. I don't remember the first time we did it, but it was a love fest. To this day, I sit and okay, you want something, here it is. But most of the time, people come up and just talk. And I don't have the time. If you see me on the street, if you see me in a restaurant, if you see me, you know, on an airplane or whatever, you really can't talk in depth in those situations because you're going someplace, you're moving, you're doing things. But here, the whole intention is for us to relate. So a lot of you who have come over to see us know that we relate to you. And this is our thanks to you for your incredible commitment to the work that we do and the life that we've been able to, privileged life that we lead. And this is the only way I know how to say thank you, is by spending time with you. And I write, you know, War and Peace. I don't know if you've seen it, but it gets me kind of funny.
People... He has the best penmanship of any actor you have ever met. So please come to our table.
It's so funny. But that to me, you know, what has been said to me, unbelievable. Unbelievable moments of true human emotion expressed by you. And there are many times when people can't even talk. They start to cry. And they're standing there and they can't talk and they can't cry. And so I start crying. And then we're sitting there, standing there, looking at each other, crying. And when they're nervous, I get more nervous than they are. And I get so excited and they're excited. When they're excited, I get more excited. And it becomes truly a gift of life. You talk about energy, you talk about understanding what this is about. This is it. That's all there is, guys. It's us. And us being able to relate with one another and finding peace, tranquility, and understanding of the light. shining deep inside of us and allowing that light to come out and allowing us to really motivate and to bring about a truth and an understanding. That's what happens when you stand in front of me, because you come up and what are you going to, hi. And then you try to, you know, many of you say, I loved you in this, I loved you in that, I loved you. I said, thank you, what do you do? Man, then the cork gets like taken off the bottle. I mean, just like, I'll be listening to, I love to listen to Mary. Mary is incredible when it comes to that. She will, hi, what do you do? And then she goes into it with him, and boy, it's amazing. And yes, people have come up and changed my life by the expressions that they've given to me. I know that I've changed yours, or else you wouldn't be sitting here. And I know that when you come over to talk to me, you've really waited a long time to come over and say hi, and just to spend 1 second of time in this world to say whatever you would like to say to us. And there's many of us out there, you know, a lot of people come, but this is the only place we can do this at. I don't know anywhere else you can actually do this, you know, at this level. And so I say to you, conventions are unbelievable. I'm so grateful for those of you who come. And thank you very much for the love that you've shared with all of us.
I can't really follow that up because it says it all. But I'll just add just one tiny thing. One thing that was a real surprise to me, and I cherish it, and I've sort of built on it in terms of how I feel, the responsibility I feel in the world, in given the gift of having a talent. You know, it's just a gift, it's not something that you can predict. I could not have predicted the amount of young women and little girls that latched on to Laura Roslin. Because you know what, despite what everybody thinks, we don't go out setting a course, I will only play leaders, or tell my agent to find me a president, a female president. Yeah, good luck back then, right? We don't do that. We sort of try to do the work, and the work draws other work. And this, so when Laura, unbeknownst to Laura and unbeknownst to Mary, playing Laura, became iconic for young women aspiring to enter the world that they are now in, which is rough, but women can lead now. And back then it was kind of rare. It sounds like it was 1800, but it wasn't. So, right? So that's just in addition to the miracle that Battlestar has given us because of these. I just wanted to say that little thing about little girls watching Laura Roslin. It was a surprise.
Rochelle, thank you.
And you were one of those little girls.
And now the gentleman dressed as a reporter from a great metropolitan newspaper.
I know, like I was looking at you going, what is that?
My name is Steve, and I want to tell you, it's extraordinary what you just said, and it goes to the question, you all were at the UN in 2009, and I saw that event, and if anybody hasn't, go to YouTube, it was Whoopi Goldberg hosting, and talk about the magnitude and the importance of your show to get to go to the UN, and you got to say that incredible truth, that there's only one race on Earth, the human race, and we're still not there. But I wanted to thank you for saying it as powerfully as you did, and knowing that. I'd like to both of you reflect on the power entertainment has to get people to think about stuff like, you know, racism is like this made up bullshit thing that puts us at war with each other. And there are other truths out there that entertainment could help bring to light, you know, like what war is obsolete, thanks to science, and there's stuff. And you've got this amazing power, and I want to thank you for using it. And just to ask you to reflect on what a marvelous well, it could be thanks to the truth of prayer.
This art form is the strongest art form the humans have ever created. There's nothing stronger than the audiovisual event, especially when it's projected on the big screen. On television, now we have the 70-inch screens, the 85-inch screens, you know, they're huge inside the house, but they used to be small screens, and even the small screen attacks the subconscious mind in a way that nothing else can. It uses all the art forms. It uses sound, it uses movement, it uses story, it uses artists of all different kinds, it uses technicians. It's a tremendous storytelling process. When this piece of work came out in 2003, it was just after the 9/11 situation in September 2001, and all of our minds were completely going through the changes of what happened to every single one of you. Everybody on the planet had to deal with this reality. So when Ron got a hold of this world and started to use it the way he was using it, like Mary said, we talked about unbelievable situations that changed the course of the way you think right now. Because of, remember I said, if you didn't see Battlestar Galactica and there was a nuclear holocaust and you lost everything in the world, you'd commit suicide and you'd want to kill yourself. But if you'd seen Battlestar Galactica, you would think to yourself and say, shit, I've seen this. I've seen that. I know what you got to do right now, okay? We got to go on living. We got to get a lot of people pregnant. Literally, guys, I mean, listen to what I'm saying, because when I said that at the UN, many of you haven't seen it, and thank you for bringing it up. It's been, 2009 when we did it. We were invited to the UN to discuss what the UN does, and they used Battlestar Galactica as a format to describe how they do reconciliation, how they talk about, children in war, how they talk about, all of the issues that we touched in our program. They would show up about a 4 or 5 minute clip, and then the executive director of that pronounced subject matter would speak. And Mary and I were there, and Ron and David Icke, and Whoopi was the moderator. And, boy, you talk about talking. The place was jam-packed. People all over the world were there. And the news coverage, there were news reporters and cameras all the way up and down the aisles. And it was jam-packed. It was the first time they had ever gotten pop culture to discuss world events, ever. They had never done this. They had never gotten a television show and discussed what the UN does off of a television show. And if you haven't seen it, you should. The whole event is on YouTube. He's talking about a piece that I did in which I say to you, and I'll say to you right now, many of you know it very well. He said, there's only one race. You know that. There's no Latino race or Caucasian race or Asian race or African race or indigenous race. No, there are cultures. There are Caucasian cultures, there are Asian cultures, there are Latino cultures. Yes, but there's only one race, everybody. And you know it. And you can't even begin to understand it because you've used the word race as a cultural determinant for so long in our understanding, since 1471, when they define the word race as races. That's when it came out. And they did it so that they can kill them. It was the different races. You can't kill your own race, so you have to make them the other. And that's what we discussed. And it was so profound in our story of Battlestar. It was ridiculous because you had every single culture under the sun was located on that battle star. They came from every single culture was on there. And so, but there was only one race. grace. And as I sit here today, it's going in one ear and it's going right out the other. Because there's no way that you can understand that there's only one race. You've been taught that there are races, and there aren't. There's only one race, and you have to decide upon yourself never to use the word race as a cultural determinant. When a bug doesn't like you, that's racial discrimination. Okay? But when a person doesn't like you because of the color of your skin, or because of your religion, or because of the way that you are, that's discrimination, period. That's, you've got to realize that by, when we got the, one of the most unifying words on the planet and turned it into a divisive word, it was over. Wait, there's no way that we're going to be able to come together. There's no way. Think about it. How can you come together when you're the other to somebody? And I'll tell you, the people, the only people who really understand this are the indigenous people. They're one with the planet. And they always have been. Anywhere you find indigenous people, they are at one with the planet and with each other. It doesn't mean that they can't, they don't fight. Of course they fight. They can't, they don't like each other, yeah. But I gotta tell you, when it comes down to understanding, they understand that there's only the human element, the human, the ultimate understanding oneself. And the compassion, the love, what really becomes the essence of who we are as human beings. When that becomes first and foremost, there is no Trump that can get involved. No Trump can get involved. There's no person who tries to make you not like somebody else with fear can get involved. That's what it's about. I can make you do things that you would not like to do, but out of fear, you'll do it. And that's the difficulty of this life. So you better come to terms with it, because guess what? Things haven't changed very much. And I don't want you guys committing suicide, all right?
I promise, because that was beautiful, Ed. And it was even, it was even more beautiful than at the UN, because the implications of what happened there are now even more clear to you. So your wisdom in relation to this has just grown. I mean, we could just let him talk, right? But what I wanted to just say was, just the other night, I was reading a book, and I think it's called Braiding Sweetgrass. Has anyone read it? Yes? Good. Yes. And it's written by a Native American woman, a brilliant woman. And something she said struck me, and I can't quote it directly because I am ADHD, I'm visual, spatial, whatever, and I have to go back and read things at least twice, if not three times. But the implication was, and I'd never heard it before, that the indigenous is in all of us, as because we are one race. It means that we live our lives profoundly and deeply connected to the rhythms of the earth. And so at any point in one's life, a decision to commit to being with the earth, you begin the path of indigenous. And I just thought that was beautiful. So pick that book up.
One last thing. I need you all to just put into your brain thrust of a documentary called Seaspiracy. S-E-A, conspiracy, but without the con. Seaspiracy. Watch it. It's on Netflix. Just watch it, okay? And watch it to the end. Don't get turned off by the realities that you're going to face. Just watch it to the end.
We are definitely going to get kicked out at this convention.
Mary, hey, real quick, is there anything on the horizon that we should check out?
I don't have anything to share at the moment.
Okay. Yeah, Blackbird is coming.
Oh yes, Blackbird is coming.
And that's all I gotta tell you. Just be aware that Blackbird is coming. I just literally, this is some breaking news, okay? Breaking news. As of right this second, I've signed on to Blackbird. As time goes on, you'll hear about it. You have to see it.
I would love to tell you about Blackbird, but I can't. But it's so astonishing. That's all I'm gonna say.
New York Comic Con 2021, this.